Thank you. Great. So now we move on to George Varga. George, I know for a long time as well. He's he has been working in finance also for a long time. And let's see what he has to tell us. Go ahead, George.
Luciano, thank you for having me here. Thank you, George, and congratulations to Marco for his birthday and Bruno for this great conference. My talk will be about term structure. I'm going to share the presentation now. Are you seeing? Do you see that, Luciano? Hello?
Yeah, it's coming. Yeah, it came. Yes.
Okay, I'm going to talk about the fitting of term structure, especially the short end of the term structure, which has been a problem among practitioners and even among people from academia that need this type of information. There's a little literature, is more an application of some numerical methods, but largely applied in practice, and even in academia where people need this type of information. Okay, so here are some references that I'm going to refer during the presentation. Okay, so I have this introduction. I'm going to show a few models that are more common, the data results, and the conclusion. Okay. So the term structure of interest rate is central to monetary policy and for practitioners of fixed income business as well. Policymakers, they do need the term structure to play with the monetary policy and figure out how does it affect the economy. And the practitioners, traders, they need it every day to find out if they are on the cheap, mark to market, and draw trading strategies. So all these people, they need this two-dimensional solution where you have the spot rate versus the maturity in order to play the monetary policy, mark-to-mark bonds, and all trading strategies. Indeed, this is what you call term structure. Okay? The problem is the term structure not completely observable. You can only see a few points. You have some bonds, and out of those bonds, you can get some rates versus maturity. You also have further complications because most bonds, they pay coupons. Then you have to use some math tools in order to get rid of the reinvestment risk. And there is a larger set of solutions to get this term structure via numerical procedures. And there is some literature more from practitioners in order to get the term structure. There are three very popular models to get the term structure out of a set of T and I function of T, set of bonds. And those three are the cubic spline, first used by McCulloch in a paper from 1975. Another one, more recent, from Nelson Siegel, a paper in 1987, largely used by central banks. There is some literature where central bankers and the research group in central banks, they show that they use Nelson Siegel to get a term structure out of the bonds that they can see in the market. And there is another one pretty common among the practitioners, which is the flat forward, where you fix a linear function out of the forward rates implied in a set of bonds. And one reference is Coleman, 1992. Okay. So these models generate different term structure, and they are especially problematic in the short end of the term structure, maturities lower than 1 year. And the long end, the maturities longer than the longest maturity bond, which means some sort of extrapolation is very difficult using those models. Okay? So this article proposes a slightly different type of flat forward interpolation that gets a much better results that compared to what you see with the Nelson Siegel and cubic spline and the popular flat forward interpolation method. And the model that I propose here, they are they work pretty well for countries where the central bank established the overnight rate in a pre-scheduled meeting, like in Brazil and several other countries, where we know that in an X day, the central bank is going to meet, and they may change the short-term interest rate. So in countries like this, this model that I propose here, which is a little change in the flat forward interpolation method, gives a much better results in terms of interpolation based on a metric that I'm going to show right now. Okay? So what we do here is use the flat forward interpolation method with fixed vertices, and between the vertices fixed by the pre-scheduled meeting, we interpolate the forward rates that are based on the set of bonds available in the market. Okay, so those things are popular. There are large literature how the central banks manage the monetary policy with pre-scheduled meetings. Okay, and I'm going to apply this result and this model for the Brazilian market and show that the fit is much better in terms of price, much better than the cubic spline or Nelson Silva. In Brazil, as a matter of fact, we have some institutions that mark to market bonds, like Bank Association BIMA, and they use cubic spline. Others use Nelson Siegel, and few others use flat forward in a different, not the way that I'm showing here. Okay? So just to compare the models, we have this McLaws 1975. It's just an application of a cubic spline on the price of the bond, not the rates, not the spot rate, neither the forward rates. So one can also use the same cubic spline model on top of the spot rate or the forward rate. But McLaws 1975 has interpolated using the discount function, which is is basically the price of a bond. Okay, so those are the bases used by McLaws to get the interpolation. And McLaws defined the same numbers of observed bonds between each vertex. So define vertices, putting the same number of bonds in between the number of vertices that he has defined. Okay? We're going to call this model McLaws MCC. Another model, very well known, is the Nelson Siegel, also applied in the market, where three factors are assembled in order to replicate some well-known behavior of the term structure, which is sometimes flat, decreasing, or concave function. In order to, so those functions are assembled in order to reproduce a typical shape of a forward rate term structure. This forward rate term structure is integrated to get the spot rate, and therefore the bond price, which is here, based on this function, based on the forward rates. And once you have this function to get the price of the bond, one can compare it and with some optimization, get the parameters of the forward rates, which the beta 1, beta 2, beta 3, and tau, which defines the curvature of the concave function. Okay. So the bond price are recovered and compared with the bond price of the model and the bond price traded in the market, one can get the parameters and get the term structure for any maturity with this function. Okay. So in Brazil, what do we have? The monetary policy, we have this meeting of called Copom, where we have a pre-scheduled data for a possible change in the very short-term rate and what people call target rate. So we know the data where we may have a change in short-term rate. So what I do is, here's a graph of what has happened recently. So what I do is, I'm going to use the flat forward model, but instead of having vertices on the date of the observed bond price, I'm going to put vertices on the date of coupon meetings, which is known in advance. At least 2 years, people know when the meeting is going to happen. So I can establish the vertices on those dates. Okay? So I'm going to get the flat forward model, but the vertex is not going to be in the bond maturity date, but on the coupon meetings date. Then I have this flat forward modified version of the flat forward. There is some discussion about the discontinuity on the forward rate curves. Okay, there are some authors that argue that the discontinuity may provide some arbitrage, but what the theory says is that you only have arbitrage in the price bond, not in the forwards. You cannot arbitrage away this type of discontinuity. Okay. And then we're going to call this model that this forward versions FFC. So what do we have? We have a flat forward rate between the dates of the coupon is on C1, C2, and C3 is the date of the central bank meeting called coupon date. And I have to have one fixed rate calculated by the model, by this flat forward model, between those dates. In order to get this F1, F2, and F3, forward rates, I have to solve this nonlinear problem where I have the model price out of this forward rate. It's pretty easy, it's a linear combination of a continuous forward rate compared to the market price of the bonds. And I waited by the duration in order to get rid of the heteroscedasticity that happens in those bonds. Okay, so this I have this optimization problem. And once I get the F1, F2, F3, I can integrate and get the spot rate for any maturity and therefore the term structure, the completely term structure. So that's the model that I proposed. I haven't seen anything in the market. We do see Nelson Siegel, Kirk Spline, and flat forward, but with vertices based on the bonds maturity, not in the central banks meeting it. This is a very simple example. Taking a typical data with price from the market. I use the MATLAB, a nonlinear optimization tool, to get the forward rates. And I compared the result with the cubic spline and MacLotch. And here are the results. So the forward rate obviously has a jump compared to the cubic spline model for this. Then how do I decide, why do I set the flat forward with vertex on the coupon date is better? Okay. Basically, there are two metrics that people use to compare term structure fitting models. One is the accuracy, which is basically the difference between the price observed in the market for the bonds that were in the sample that I used to estimate the model, and the price out of the model. So this error generated by my model compared to the market price. Okay. And I'm gonna add all the errors for all the price that I observe in the market. And I'm gonna calculate this room mean squared error, okay, in order to evaluate each model. Another method that people use is the smoothness of the forward rate, which doesn't apply here because by construction, my model does have a very low smoothness because by construction, I have a jump in the coupon rate, coupon meeting date. Okay? So I won't use the smoothness rate because it doesn't make sense for this type of application. Okay? So the only metric here to evaluate the model and compare those three models will be the accuracy rate metrics. Well, there is a list of comparison based on the errors, the accuracy metrics that was done by BIS, applied to US markets in order to find out what's going on with the predictability, the fitness, and the randomness of the errors. And I just replicate the same study to Brazil, but using this different type of different type of models. Okay. Well, the data is Brazilian futures, which is the most used bond price in Brazil. This is the reference for term structure in Brazil. Very liquid, have no liquidity problem in order to get price. And I'm going to compare all those models using the futures interest rates traded in Brazil. I could use bonds, but bonds are less liquid, and therefore I have a better contract to play with my models. Okay. And I'm especially concerned with the short end of the term structure. It has been problematic. And also, I won't be able to apply my model for a term longer than the short term, because I don't know when it's going to happen, the Copom meeting. Okay. So another advantage of the DI future, it has no coupons, so that it has no reinvestment risk. It's guaranteed by the stock exchange. It's a highly credit quality and has no optionality in itself. So it's not like a bond that may have optionality and would create problem to compare the models. Okay. So then I have here the absolutely daily error for each model. And the difference is substantial. The FFC model, the model I propose here, has only 16% of the average error of the McLosh cubic spline. And even compared to the other models like Nelson Sigurd, it also has a much, much lower error. So the accuracy rate is much, much better than any other model as we expected. Then I have the evolution of the average absolute error. And what you see is some clustering of the errors in the McLosh spline and Nelson Sigurd as well. And they're very, very low. You basically don't see much clustering in the same data that you see in the McLosh and Nelson Sigurd models. To evaluate the new hypothesis of equality of the models, I use a Friedman non-parametric tests, and all the pairs they do reject the new hypothesis of equality of the models. So the models are really different, 95% probability. To verify the randomness of the error, I check if the errors are followed by the same sign of the errors in order to get some condition of frequency. And I do find some strong positive autocorrelation of there, which suggests that we may have some missing factor in the cubic spline and Nelson Sigurd, but very small in the proposed model in this paper. And to see if there is a relationship between the model generated by one model versus the other, I have this table of error coincidence. So I have some conditional frequency on each model based on what happened in the same moment in the other model. Okay. So the overall result suggests that the models are different. The errors most likely have some specific source when there are errors, although the errors in the proposed model here is very small. One factor that may explain the errors, even the FFC model, is the liquidity. Although using the futures liquidity is a small issue. On the contrary, when you use the bond price, liquidity may be an issue. Mm. That's it. So traditional models like cubic spline or Nelson Sigurd that have been largely used by central banks and market practitioners in Brazil have some institutions that do use this type of model to calculate the term structure in mark-to-market bonds. They have been problematic. They have the fitting is not that good when you compare the bond price and the fitting provided by the model, and especially problematic in the short end. So I proposed this model with a little modification on the flat forward that has had a very, very low error, especially in the short end. And, also for longer end, I cannot apply this type of model. Thank you for your time, and happy birthday to Marco. Comments are welcome, and my email is here.
Thank you, George. Great. I have a couple of questions. So you, the data that you presented was related more to Brazil in a short time interval. I believe it's just 2020. Have you tried, so my question is, have you tried the other time intervals for Brazil and also somewhat in the same direction? Have you considered this model in other countries?
Yes. I did try other periods, okay, but I have in some periods, for instance, before 2001, the tenor was very small. Before 2001, you had the liquidity for less than 1 year, so it was quite hard to compare the models. You have to have a sample to calculate the parameters of Nelson Siegel and the others. So it was very hard to do for peers before 2010. After 2010, the term structure has really extended for more than 10 years. So I found that in order to make my point, if I do something after 2010 or 2015, I will be able to make my point. But I did some calculations for 10 years before 2015, and the result is pretty much the same.
Okay, and other countries, have you experimented?
Yeah, I'm about to do that. Although there is one difference, because the futures, they don't work like in Brazil, so it's a little bit harder to use futures, and to use bonds, then you introduce a new noise, which is the liquidity. But I intend to... for a country that has the same type of monetary policy.
Great. Another question is, the function that you're minimizing is, in some sense, is just the quadratic distance, right?
Yes.
So I'm pretty standard. And I was curious if other people haven't tried this as well before.
Yeah, people do the, you talk about the model that I proposed here. Yeah, I haven't seen anything published, but if you talk to people in the market, some people try to do, but they have no idea how to do that, at least the people that I've talked to. So what people use is the standard procedure that you have in the market now, the Nelson Siegel and cubic spline, and some people do the flat forward with vertices fixed on the futures maturity, not on the coupon maturity. But I haven't seen anything published, but I've seen some people, oh, maybe if you change, but then you have a problem because you don't have enough maturity sometimes, then you have, sometimes you have more than one maturity. You have some problems minimizing this function because sometimes you don't have any observation between two maturities.
Okay. So I have a final question, then some questions from the audience. Let me ask the first the audience question. I think I'll keep mine for the end. One drawback of this model is that the YC parameter changes every day. The yield curve is expressed in terms of time to maturity and not maturity date. Bad dates change every day. I mean, Fed meetings turn to maturity changes every day. Any comment on that?
But the Fed's meetings, they are pre-scheduled, although you do have ordinary, extraordinary meetings, which may change the calculations and and my model. But right now, at any time, you do have some... So it doesn't touch in the at the end of the day. The point is, my model gets a very, very low error compared to the bonds price. So you can improve and make my model different. Although the model that the way that I set up the model, it does get a very, very low error. So it's better than using Nelson Siegel and cubic spline, which is the what people are using the market right now. So we may have something better, but what I have is better than the is sold in the market right now.
Okay, great. So my final question is kind of a semi-joke. So of course, when you talk with people in the academia, you cannot ask if they are making money because they don't care about money, right? But yeah. Since you are in a company, I may ask you, are you making money with this model?
Yeah, somehow, yes, we sell some products, but not trading with this. But I do okay. sell, you know, but that sell, provide data and other things. We do okay, use
great
pricing.
Okay, George, thank you very much. It was great. Thank you all, Martino, Alberto, and Giorgio. It was a great session. And I think we'll now go to a break. There is George Zubelli put a note here. If someone wants to, if some of the people here watching us want to discuss RAF volatility, there is a link there in the YouTube. You can just follow. Okay, guys, thank you very much.
Thank
it
you.
Was great talking. See you. Bye-bye.